live from the Villiga North America Studios here in Warwick, Rhode Island at the G-Unit Studio. This week on Stogie Geeks, we welcome back Robert Holt of Southern Draw Cigars. And in the Debonair Ideal segment, we're going to talk about top 25 cigars rated by Cigar Aficionado in 2016 and Stogies of the Week.
This is a Security Weekly production. Broadcasting live from G-Unit Studios in Rhode Island, it's the show where cigars burn slow, ashes fall fast, and cocktails flow steady. It's the Stogie Geek Show.
To you by Mbombe Cigars represent the most admired cigar culture of Cuba. They select the best of the best quality tobacco to use in the aging process. Mbombe Cigars are then rolled in Costa Rica by some of the most experienced cigar rollers, giving it a unique smoking experience. The band portrays a detailed and artistic nature of our small industry. Try the Mbombe Casera, the Mbombe Mora, and the recently released Mbombe Habano. Mbombe Cigars, where the cigar is a way of life. And by Punch Cigars. For more information, check them out at www.punchcigars.com. Havana Cigar Club, located in Warwick, Rhode Island, is a great place to enjoy a drink and a cigar. Stogie Geeks listeners can find a $5 off coupon on our website by clicking the HCC logo. Duran Premium Cigars, one of the fastest growing boutique cigar companies, provides smokers a portal into the old Cuban tradition of the perfect balance and the lost art of progressive flavor construction. Roberto Pelayo Duran began his career in tobacco over 2 decades ago in Havana, where his reputation grew within Cuban circles. The creation of Duran Premium Cigars has given Roberto the platform to introduce a series of cigars that offer the quality and construction that he perfected while in Cuba. Brands include the ultra-premium Roberto P. Duran Signature Line, Azan, Nea, and Baracoa. Duran uses a seed-to-humidor approach as all of their tobacco is grown in their farms and rolled in their factory in Esteli, Nicaragua. Rollers have been carefully chosen to carry out Roberto's precise method to ensure progressive flavor in each cigar. Duran Premium Cigars invites you to make their premium your standard.
Hey, Paul, what's up?
What's up, Mark?
Did you hear about the new cigar that's coming out?
Which one is that? There's like 800 new ones every week.
The one with the Connecticut Broadleaf wrapper.
Oh, really? I love Connecticut Broadleaf. Who makes it?
I think it's Nicaraguan.
So Nicaraguan binder and filler, or it's made in a factory in Nicaragua?
I always have to Google these, and it's taking me like an hour to find out what it is.
If this is a frequent conversation with your cigar buddies, look no further than Stogie Geeks News, the only cigar news podcast on the internet. Will Cooper, the man behind Cigar-Coop.com, and Paul Asadorian from the Stogie Geeks produce a weekly show covering the latest cigar news, new blends, cigar manufacturer announcements, and more. Subscribe to the video version on YouTube or get the audio version in your favorite podcast catcher. Head on over to StogieNews.tv to subscribe today.
Welcome to episode 218 of Stogie Geeks. We are here at the G-Unit Studios in Warwick, Rhode Island. The drinks are flowing. We have Robert Holt from Southern Draw Cigars and Mr. Will Cooper. How are you, gentlemen?
Hey, Joe. How's it going
today? Wonderful.
I just want to stop and pause. It's going great. I'm sitting in Paul's seat, and I must say, very comfortable.
You know, there's things, you know, once you get the chair, you don't give it up. You may have to find other arrangements for Paul to have a different chair, is what I'm saying.
Well, we'll have to see on the next episode, right? Episode 219. Here's our new host. Joe's gone, right? Welcome, gentlemen. How are you?
Doing good.
Hey, Joe, doing well.
Joe, I got to ask you, because we didn't really talk about this before the show. Are you a football guy?
Yes.
So you must be very, very happy.
Yes. If you follow me on Instagram, I actually have, Converse All-Stars, the Chuckies? I have Patriots Chuckies, and I wore them all day yesterday. I went to a Bruins game, the Providence Bruins, and then we went to the Patriots. So it was all sports yesterday. Very excited, and for the first time, I'm very excited to it looks like the Patriots are going to have a great opponent. It's going to be a great Super Bowl.
Yeah, so full disclaimer, I'm not a Falcons fan, but I am rooting for the Falcons, and it's no disrespect on the Patriots. I think a great organization. But a lot of people know I'm a Michael Turner fanboy, who was a running back for them, who I've gotten to know, and it's his former team, and I want to see him do well. So that's my sole reason for rooting for the Falcons, is out of friendship to him.
Yeah, I think next week I'm going to wear my Patriots Chuckies for sure.
Yeah, you definitely got to do it, because it's better than Paul's Uggs. Yeah. As Paul, yeah, so that would be a major improvement in the shoe attire.
Right, for sure. Yeah, yeah. looking forward to the Providence Bruins did not do well at all yesterday. It was terrible. They had open net with 8 minutes left. They were taking chances. It was sloppy hockey, for sure, you know.
Now, in terms of a farm team for the Boston Bruins, are they how are they stocked in terms of maybe young guys? Could Boston look forward to a lot of good young guys?
Yeah, for sure. It's definitely a good incubator program for the Boston. I mean, before the goalie came from there, and the goalie this year is not that, you know, it's not that well, but had a chance to sit in one of the sky boots at one of my local vendors, the Coast Guard House. So we had the Falcons game on the suite in the back of us, and then we had the actual live hockey game there, and we, you know, ate $40 pizza and all that stuff. It was a good time.
That's great. Yeah, I love minor league hockey, actually. So we have the Charlotte Checkers in Charlotte. So I do like that.
Yeah, it's definitely good, you know, and they're doing well as far as attendance and sponsorship and all that type stuff. So it's definitely a good venue. If you're ever in Providence, stop by and check them out.
Absolutely.
Hey Joe.
Yes.
On the live stream, Paul says don't get too comfortable in that chair.
All right. Do I have to move, or am I good?
He's watching, but no.
So you want to get right into the interview? I mean, Southern Draw, I was exposed to them about 6 months ago myself, you know. Had a chance to catch them over at the Havana Club, you know, and it came in a five-pack, and I got it, and it was good, you know. I'm digging the Habano, and right now I'm on the Kudzu, the Toro size. It's definitely good.
Robert, you there?
Beautiful. So, yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's wonderful, because I'm not used to that. I just had to sit outside so I could smoke, but I tell you what, the weather keeps kind of coming around me here in sunny Southern California, right? Sunny Southern California. But we're braving it anyway. Now, we miss Brother Paul there, and I hope this isn't like the NFL, where he misses a game, and the next thing you know, Joe's gone 13-3 and can't get his spot back, you know?
I don't know.
Paul is like Tom Brady, though. I mean, he could, you know, we can keep him out for four games. Man, he'll come back and bring the MVP performance, so I think we're all good there, too. But Joe's doing a great job. Joe is doing a great job tonight, so... And I do like the way he looks in the chair. So
right, it's comfortable. It fits me.
Yeah, I tell you why. Yeah, you're a natural in that. Yeah.
It looks official.
I like it. Let's go for it. Will, you got a question for Robert?
Yes.
Let's do it up.
So Robert, I mean, we've had you on the show. It's probably about a year ago, but we do have a lot of new folks in the audience. So why don't you give us a little 101 of the beginnings of Southern Draw Cigars?
I don't know if I'll go all the way back to 101, but, you know, where we are today is, you know, in Southern Draw Cigars, based in Austin, Texas, and I think most people in the media consumer side of the business realize that we've worked hand-in-hand with Tabacalera Fernandez there in Esteli, Nicaragua, with Brother AJ, all of his wonderful team and staff, and it's just provided us a nice baseline for the two things we wanted most, which is consistency and sustainability of our blends. So there's not a lot of blends. There's not too many sizes of each of our cigars out there, but we're starting to fill the spectrum. And we'll talk a little bit about today about where we came from, but where we're going here in the near future. So, you know, we had a great year last year. Right now, I think Draw's available just over 400 retail locations. So we've been blessed over the last couple of years, and we're getting to spend more and more time in the retail sector and spending time with the consumer. So it's just been a nice journey. I think tough times with the unknowns of the FDA fought through it, I think. So we'll continue our march, if you will, and kind of spreading what we believe is kind of a nice collaboration of Southern culture and hospitality, and just kind of be social and enjoy ourselves over a couple of cigars and a conversation.
Absolutely. You know, Joe, you started out with Robert. Joe started out with you have a wine or something tonight there, but no. But Robert, you started with two core lines, Kudzu and Firethorn, and I believe from what you told us the last time, they were kind of the names of flowers, correct?
They are. They're flowering plants, if you will. That's correct.
Yep. So kind of the skinny of those two blends is you have one that's an Oscuro, which is what Joe and I have spoken, we're spoken to Kudzu, and we have a couple of variations. And then the Firethorn is your Habano, correct?
That's correct. The Firethorn is Habano Rosado, but it does have a little San Andreas Maduro binder to it, so a little bit different use of that San Andreas. The Firethorn being more of a medium plus, if you will, profile. And then Kudzu, some people think it's full, but to me it's a full, medium to full-bodied cigar with the Oscuro and some of the beautiful Nicaraguan Ometepe and the beautiful Nicaraguan fillers that we have in there. It's just been a real popular cigar for us.
And for the most part, you've taken those two lines, and that's kind of been your foundation, you would say, right?
I won't discount the Quick Draw line because the Quick Draw line has its own purpose. On a percent angle, but the core lines themselves, Kudzu, Firethorn, we started with Robusto, Toro, Gordo, and then after that, we wanted to show a little bit about the diversity of those tobaccos in the blend. So, one of your Will, you're smoking the Lancero, a little bit different use
right.
of that tobacco, definitely a different profile. It's the only Kudzu we have that's not box pressed, as you can recall. So it's a more of a rustic format, in that round format. It burns differently, tastes differently, but that's intentional. We want to show the diversity of not just, you know, really rest on the laurels of those first three, you know, Vitolas that we launched this with.
What does the axle mean?
The Kudzu, again, is a invasive flowering plant, and where the vine splits off and creates a flower, which is where the majority of the sugars and the flavors of that plant come into play to create the purple flowers, where it splits off from the vine to become the flower is known as the axle. So with that small format in the Lancero, the 6.5 by 40, you're going to get more intensity and more intense flavor from the Oscuro. So the richer, a bit fuller to me. So the axle kind of made sense for us to say, you know, that's a little bit better representation of the pure wrapper in that blend as opposed to the Robusto, the Toro, and the Gordo.
So what made you in, you know, you always hear Lanceros, everybody loves them, but they don't sell. What made you go down the Lancero route with this?
Agreed. you know, it's and we call it a Lancero, right? That's a rule of thumb. But it's a 6.5 by 40. And to stay with our objective, which is consistency and sustainability, for us, that blend really maintains a good burn rate, a good burn temperature, a good experience at a 6.5 by 40. So we were unable to feel real comfortable with the 7.7, you know, and a quarter by 38, more of a traditional Lancero. So we stuck with the 6.5 by 40, and it's just I enjoy small ring gauge cigars. So we've given it a shot. We produced, I think, 400 boxes this year that we released, and they've sold well. Even for folks that are just opposed to Lanceros, if we can get them to try it, you know, it seems like they're enjoying it as a nice extension to this blend.
I really like the 6.5 by 40 format for Lancero. I like the fact it has a little less length, and I like that it has a little more ring. To me, I think that's a real sweet spot for Lancero. And to me, that size is just the ideal one with me. So I think I give you big applause there, Robert.
Well, I thank you. I appreciate it. You know, the 6.5 is that little larger ring gauge for me. We haven't experienced the tightness that kind of sneaks in sometimes to production on smaller ring gauge. It really takes a refined pair of bullets to grow a roll of consistent Lancero, and there's some great ones out there. But for me, this blend and these tobaccos, the 40 was the right choice for us all, I think.
Yep. And then on the Fire Thorn, which is your Rosado, it's not that you just put a Rosado on that. It's a different blend completely than the Kodzu. Correct? Because that's the one that has the San Andreas body.
Oh, absolutely. The Firethorn is a completely different blend. That is the Ecuador and Habano Rosado. It's actually a collateral. But what happens is, with that San Andreas binder, four different Nicaraguan fillers in that Firethorn blend, including one that is very unique from the Pueblo Nuevo farm, which has some just incredible flavors and aromas that I haven't experienced in other tobaccos, specifically in Nicaragua. It's a unique blend in itself, but that Rosado offering a little subtle spice, a little more of a flutter of spice versus an in-your-face peppery that you wrap cigar. I love San Andreas, but there's so many wonderful blends out there. There's so many wonderful cigar makers that have utilized that San Andreas, both in the Duro and the Natural. That's something that, one, it's not about competition, but it is about finding a creative way to use that tobacco. And I just enjoy it enough spice and enough power to really keep my attention when I want something, you know, medium to full body.
Now, Pueblo Nuevo, it's an area north of Esteli, correct? Because I think I drove through there coming out of Honduras, and I think it was pointed out to me that this is where tobaccos were coming from. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. You're correct. And up to this point, there's only been a couple of farms there, and I'm sure as the success of those tobaccos, especially with someone that has great success, tobaccos coming off the farms, you'll see more and more. But it is a very terrain and soil and sun and water condition that to me just lends itself to one of the most unique tobaccos, especially if you can add a nuance or something as a subtle flavor in the filler side of the business. So I'm excited about it. I think I like what he's doing up there, exploring this new territory and these new terrains.
Absolutely. And in the Fire Thorn, the 6.5x40 is the Palme Lancero. Is that, am I saying that right?
You know, you can say palme, but really palm, and think about palm, and the land, the Firethorn is named after the another flowering plant, but the fruit, the berries on a Firethorn, this is a shrub that has little thorns, obviously, and little red berries, much like an apple. An apple or a fruit-bearing plant is also known as a palm, P-O-M-P. So here we go. Intensity where the majority of the sugars of that plant concentrate, it creates the bloom or the fruit. That Lancero similarly does that with those profiles. A little stronger format, a little more robust, and to me a completely unique blend coming out of the Lancero and the Firethorn palm. So a little different name there, because I think to me a very different cigar.
Absolutely, and I've had that, that is another great representation of that Firethorn blend, which is one that I have gravitated to as well. So I want to kind of turn attention over to Code Duelo, which I think was one of the coolest projects to come out with. And actually, you and I had a little bit of a Code Duelo when we were in Charlotte. We actually had a little bit of that. Why don't you talk about the Code Duelo concept?
Yeah, here again, our objective was twofold with the Code Duelo. One is to create another unique experience using the same tobaccos, and two is to share a message. And in this age of struggles and strife and Republicans and Democrats and your president and my president and evildoers of the world, I mean, we really wanted to get back to settling differences and disputes. So the term Code Duelo here again is a term used to settle disputes from the Middle Ages until modern day, which is it's gone from swords and pistols and quick draws to really just sit down and have a conversation. So the Code Duelo, we in the Firethorn and the Kudzu, we did two unique things. We created a 656 in each of those that really highlights the wrapper. In this case, it would be for the kudzu, and on the fire thorn, it would be the rosado. And we also did a 5x58. It kind of gave you a little Gordo Perfecto. And the highlight there, the profile of the binders in those two cigars. So in one, it was the Omatepe, the kudzu, getting into that oaky char richness and those beautiful aromas of Omatepe. And then in the Firethorn, really highlighting that San Andreas, that spice, that level of nicotine, seeing that kind of pick that profile a little bit. And in each of those, we bundled them or double banded them with the Code Duelo band. So in the 656 or the 558, you had two of the exact same cigars with the tagline. And maybe we didn't do a great job on the marketing. We're just little guys. We're learning. But the tagline really is settle it like gentlemen. And you sit down with a cigar and have a similar cigar, the same cigar, and you could sit down and have a conversation. Maybe it gives you a common point to have a discussion. We don't have to get into politics and religion and warfare and our differences, but let's start our conversations with something similar. And I think it's a message that's starting to really take root and starting to come back to us and say, we get it now. So we kind of gravitate to of cigars and sitting down with somebody and having something common to begin a conversation.
Right, and then just to point out that those four the Tolas, they're four different blends from what the kudzu and the firethorn, the core line is, correct?
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I definitely, I know
they
we
are
had
unique profiles.
Yeah, because when you came to Charlotte, we actually dueled it out, and I remember when I lit it up. It was the first time I lit up. It was great. It was a great cigar, and I think we smoked the Firethorns that night. I want to say the 56 that night. You have a really good memory, but I think it was the Firethorn.
I recall. 56.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, and I was like I said, it was
a cigar.
Absolutely.
Correct.
And then,
yeah,
you know,
we
Paul
were
and
at,
I.
Cigar.
Did we lose Robert?
I stepped on you a little bit.
No, I think we lost you for a second. So, why don't you repeat? You said you were about to tell us where we were.
I believe we were at Cigar Sector 2, were we not?
Yep. We're at my friends over at Cigar Etcetera 2. It's Larry Young's place, and my friend, his name, code name is Joe Schmo. we were there at night, so
yeah.
I remember we were watching some football that night, and Paul and I actually went and we did a Stogie Geek shorts on the whole kind of dual banded thing, and that kind of inspired us to do that, which was a lot of fun. You know, I think there's the idea of having these cigars in tandem. There really is something to it. Besides getting a great smoke, you can, if you're the Stogie Geek, like, Joe, Paul, and I are, we can compare and contrast those notes as well on it because we're both smoking something identical.
And I think that was a good way to use what we did that day, Will, when you guys went back and discussed it and you had a show and you'd mentioned the Moya Nunchuck and some other things that have happened. We really didn't do it as a gimmick. I'm going to be honest. We did it to share a message. And I hope over time that message becomes clearer to everybody that it really wasn't just meant to be in fun. It was really meant to be a message that I want people to take away from it, which is really start with something common and let's forget our differences or settle our differences if at all possible. But, yeah, it was. I had Glenn Seegers with me, and we sat over in the corner, and it was a little bit loud that night. And we did, in fact, have the 656. And we had them almost fresh. I mean, they were still kind of the prototype samples. They weren't even the boxed cigars. So what I can't wait for this year is for you guys to get the 2017 version later in the year because we're going to let them age a little bit longer. They just develop so nicely with a little more time. So this year, instead of being anxious and get them in everybody's tins, sit back on them a little bit and make sure when you get them, they're optimal.
Absolutely. Will Cooper here with Joe Hazempa. We have Robert Holt of Southern Dry Cigars as our special guest. Joe, I've been kind of monopolizing this. Let me give you a chance to ask a few questions here.
Oh yeah, no worries. I think your message is very important from a product positioning standpoint. You know, it's very, you know, I think sometimes when we're chasing cigars or having different cigars, we miss the message about, you know, getting together with either family or friends or comrades and just really, really enjoying the moment and really focusing on the moment and taking time out of our busy lives to actually do that. So I think your message, you know, I do like some of the names, absolutely, for sure. From a product positioning standpoint, what's the future? Well, are you going to continue with these blends and trying to get into more retail shops, or do you got some new blends coming up on the horizon? Or are you waiting?
Good questions, Joe.
Are you waiting for the big decision from the FDA, and you're just kind of waiting, like almost like everyone else?
Yeah, I can say this: we're not ignorant to the FDA, but we're not being. Our efforts are not being dictated. We have hopes, mm-hmm. We have dreams, and we believe that as an industry, and whether they're on the CRA, FDR, state associations, the media association, consumers, everybody seems to be very active. I can just only hope and pray to the good Lord that he'll take care of us as an industry involved, but very important. But we're not dictating our approach based on what might or might not happen. So the Kudzu and the Firethorn were nice entrances to the business, and I do care what everybody thinks. I do care what the masses think. I care about what you at the media say. I care about what retailers say. I care about consumers. I care about my partners, and my partners meaning financial partners, families, our factory partners, our box or label company. I care that everybody's contributing to this. I want them to be proud of what we are. The quick draw line, you know, is a line we haven't talked about a lot. That really is a showcase of small gauge 30 to 40 minute cigars where we have plans and we won't spend them. But moving forward, we're packaging in February a blend that we've released. In a very limited capacity. It is our first entrance into a core Connecticut blend. Mm. And this is a prototype. So you're getting a peek. That's our prototype. And it's a little, because I'm outside, but this I'm very excited about. Was a share also. We have a little connotation. We have a little homage to my wife that runs half of our business. More importantly, this is our first core line that's a Connecticut wrapper. But not like our other blends. It's in Ecuador and Connecticut. It is predominantly in Nicaraguan by fillers, but there is a very unique Piloto blend that just gives us another level of flavor and aroma, and it's going to keep people interested. So on the 1st of March, we'll see Robusto Toro Gordo. It's a semi-box pressed or a soft press Connecticut known as the Rose of Sharon, and I'm going to get those into your guys' hands pretty quickly here. So within the month, you're going to see the first of two exciting releases that we have for general edition this year. So what will happen then is you have on the left side, you have the Rose of Sharon Connecticut, mild to medium. Then you have the Thorn, which is really a medium plus, and then that Kudzu, which you're both enjoying, medium full. And then we're going to really come out with a bold statement, and that's Jacob's Ladder. And this has all been announced, and we'll go through the process. But this is our Pennsylvania broadleaf. This is a full-bodied flavor. I mean, it has the strength of a Dominican double triple arrow, but it has the complexity, the richness, the decadence of what to me only Nicaragua really provides. So. Between May and IPCPR, and that is going to dictate what happens with the industry leading up to the show. So we may release it before. They're ready. They're produced. You know, we've only had them in a couple of locations up to this point since August of last year, but that's going to really fill our four core, three quick draw for our immediate plans for Southern Grill.
Mm. So, March and May are really the target dates.
Sure. We're looking around March 1st.
Yep.
And the thing about it is we did for any of our retailers that are in good standing, and I think about 10% of the initial production has already been sold for the Rose of Sharon. We have not allowed pre-sale for Jacob's Ladder, because if everything works the way I think I'll believe it will, see everybody show, a nice place to be social and hang out and have a cup of coffee. But I would love to reserve our general distribution and release of the Jacob's Ladder for that. There's always a lot of new blends and a lot of new products. You guys may know that Southern Draw has never presented at IPCPR. We've attended, we've done our meetings, we've done our business, but never. Last year we got caught up with some deadlines for that August 8th deadline. So it would be our first year to have a booth, have staff, and really be able to spend time throughout that week there in August with everybody. So why didn't that work out for us?
Robert, I got to commend you on two things, okay? So first of all, thank you from a media standpoint. You are as good as anyone has been in the media about getting us information on stuff. And it's very, very difficult sometimes when we want to try to tell our audience about a cigar. I mean, you've been fantastic. So, I mean, I really want to thank you on the air personally for that. And I know a lot of other people in the media appreciate that. The second thing I want to make a point on is you did another smart thing that a lot of people, I think, and you actually released this in a press release, so I don't think I'm telling any secrets, but you came out with a bunch of different packaging options, which I was surprised. I wasn't surprised that you did it. I mean, I was surprised we didn't see more of that, you know, in terms of you came out with, you know, I may get the quantities, but you have a lot of 5-pack options, 10-pack, 20 count, which under the FDA, you know, is something that you had to do before August 8th, because if you come out with a 20 count box and you didn't have a 10 count box, guess what? You can't come out with that 10 count box. So that was a very smart business move I think you made with that.
Yeah, and I appreciate it. Respond to about the media. Listen, brand doesn't believe we're any more important than any other person. We're not here to promote Southern Draw. We're here for culture, lifestyle. The media and the publications play a big part. The retailers and the consumers, and anybody that's supporting us, anybody that's providing some information to the industry deserves to have correspondence and information, and very timely. And we'll continue to do that, you know, within our power and our own resources. But I think it's vital. You know, more and more people really building a brand. One thing we're trying to save an industry and to grow an industry, and through collaboration, that's the only way I believe that we can achieve that. And then on the packaging side, we weren't in a panic, but you know, you look at May when the deeming regs are released and have an effective date. We had hopes and dreams. We were just starting our second year. We had blends in the book. We had package off. We had promotions that we wanted to do. We've never been afforded that before. We've never been afforded little boxes or special promotional items. We just made a decision to buckle down for 3 or 4 months, get every produce. And again, the accolades go Cigar Rings and go to Tobacco Home Boxes, the Tabacalera Fernandez. Yes, it goes to our staff, our partners, the media partners, but everybody had to really make us a priority during that very busy time, and I appreciate it. It gave us, we've got some arrows in the quiver to move forward, and we're afforded that opportunity for the long term to see that realized. But it was intentional, but it took a lot of other folks to help achieve that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I don't, you know, and you know, you guys, I think that effort you put in right around the IPCPR, I think you've really seen you're seeing the payback of it. So, you know, a lot of people always wonder, hey, if someone's not going to IPCPR, what does that mean? Well, I think you proved that. To focus on your business and getting things moving, I think you're really seeing the benefit of that. So I give you credit on that.
I hope we do, Will. You know, we did get a kind of a black eye during the 3 or 4 months following. You weren't there. That means you've given up. It means you've quit. It means you really aren't in it. I can't change that perception other than us continue to be active, continue to be productive, and continue to release our innovations, right? But, you know, we had to make that decision. It wasn't a hard decision. We talked about it before. We missed our time, the social time, and the parties, and the time we had to spend time together at the show. But the trade-off for us would have been too risky. So, you know, hopefully we're going to regain that trust with the retailers that were coming to open accounts that have not opened accounts since. But hopefully they'll see the long haul. Our partners are behind us, and we can offer them something to put on the shelves that move and that we're going to. So only time will tell, but we hope that we played our cards right on that.
Absolutely. No, it did a great job. Joe, turn it back over to you for some questions.
Oh, yeah. No, I think it was well played. I mean, you know, first and foremost, from a business perspective, you have to focus on the sustainability of the business, and you have to go with your gut and with your partners and all that stuff. And you know, you said that you were in over 400 retailers. Is that still correct? Over 400. That's
correct.
That's no easy feat. You know what I mean? Especially for not showing up to a show, you know, and then going out there. And I'm sure that was grassroots. Take us through that process, right quick. You know, you go and visit a shop, and you're like, hey, you know, I got these cigars. You know.
Well, you know, with our brand, really the image of this conservative, family-based, trying to share the best of what we grew up with as a culture. I'm from California. I spent the majority of childhood in Texas, and my wife is a very conservative Southern girl. And, you know, there's some bad and good connotations, but what happened when everybody else went to the show, we just continued our path. I don't go to retailers to sell. I'm not with the briefcase and price sheets and catalogs. Mm-hmm. It's really meant to be a social experience. It's meant to be, let's have a conversation. Let's see what's moving well. Let's talk about your plans. Let's share a couple of sticks. And what I found is, and what we found as a company, if the retailers and the consumers we're going to fulfill whatever space on the shelves that they have available to us, so we're mindful that it may be only one or two faces. But if we continue to support that, they're going to give us more real estate. I know that, I mean, whether it's a shop in Texas or it's you know, a Monte Cristo lounge in Chicago or Florida or D.C. So we just have to live with it. But we're more social, and that pressure also alleviates the need sometimes just to have to keep calling and try to coordinate a meeting with the owner or the manager or the person, right? We're just there to be social, and we hope and we that it'll continue fruitful for us just to be more. And there's enough consumers asking for the product. You media guys play a lot of role in that, guys. I mean, don't discount the importance of ratings and reviews and your discussion in your live shows or your social media feeds, because that is what people recognize in geographic territories. Media is strong in different places. But if we can spend time with you and spend time in the shows, I think ultimately we'll need to grow the way we have.
Yeah, from a consumer perspective, I went next door over to the Havana Club, and they told me all about your company. You know, they're like, oh, who are you interviewing today? I told them who we were interviewing, and they're like, oh yeah, he's a great guy. You know, he's got veteran experience, veteran based company, family guy. You know, it's definitely going to be a good interview for you. And so, just from that one shop that I went into today and just spoke about you on the fly, they were very receptive to the brand for sure. And just so you know, you're on the corner.
Good to hear it. I appreciate
you're
that.
You're on a corner end cap in the humidor. So.
Nice. Yeah, nice. You know, what's funny, we're in shops that I don't know about that probably aren't on the list yet on my website. We both that. Office. set up an account with Sharon, maybe I don't know about it. So I try to stay on top of it, but I want to make sure that the shops on my list to visit this year. I think I had over 100 events myself, and I had the luxury of traveling, and I was supported by a lot of folks to make sure it was coordinated. But whether it's a full event or a cut and light, a meet and greet, or a multi-vendor event, and we anticipate we'll do another 100 this year. So we're going to do better about getting into all the territories, into all the shops that support us, and spend time with the staff before or after hours, and with the customers. So I think maybe the people that get shorted sometimes are the folks that are working at the retail locations during our visits, because they don't get downtime. So we want to make it a point before or after hours to start spending more time with the staff.
That's actually a well-played move, because those are the people on the front line who are going to talk about the stick when it comes to the consumer, especially right. If they ever get a consumer who's like, you know, I'm looking for something different, or, you know, I'm looking for something newer to try, or, you know, and if they know their palate from a retail perspective and they've had the opportunity to meet you, they'll definitely push the brand for sure.
Yeah, you know, Robert, I got to give you some credit too. It's kind of all that education, and it's not just educating the media; it's educating the retailer. And you've even gone direct to the consumer and educated them. Those Facebook videos you do are awesome, right? Because they learn a little bit about your product, they learn a little bit about who you are and your company is, and they're entertaining as well. So, I mean, you have done a great job, I think, at really for a small company. And Joe kind of alluded to this grassroots effort. All these things have come, and I think that's why you're seeing the growth you're starting to see right now. 400 shops for a company, you know, that's not that old is still – that's a great achievement. You're a very small company.
Yeah,
you know, so.
And then from my perspective, 400 shops from a company that's never showed up to a major show or mm-hmm. who haven't showed up to the big show, you know, it just proves that, you know, the efforts are definitely going to bear fruit for you. And then,
absolutely.
You know, think about it. You got 400 champions who have your brand, and then now potentially you're going to be on a bigger stage. And, you know, when you showcase your brand, it's just going to take it right to the next level.
Well, we look forward to it. We do. Campaign is there's not a lot of downtime, but you know, if you can spend 15 or 20 minutes once or twice a week to connect with you run into people in these shops and you run into family couples, it's been fun because you want to make sure you acknowledge that. You want to make sure that their time and effort and how they support us, how they went out is acknowledged. And I think our videos are a lot about, or my videos, you know, I kind of get it in my head that maybe, you know, Eric Espinosa helped me with something, or maybe Skip helped me with something, or maybe this family down in Houston helped and promoted us and really found a way to drive 150 miles to come see us. Those need to be acknowledged, which is we need to acknowledge our brand and our growth down those relationships and the desire to build those relationships everywhere we go. We don't have a following yet, right? We're not that way. I think through time together, and if we continue to acknowledge folks, they seem to be more, you know, brand and a long-term support for us.
It's a good effort for sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Will, do you have any more questions?
Robert, yeah, I mean, where are you hitting the road? I guess the last question in the next few weeks, so folks want to kind of see. Do you have some events planned in some areas you're going to be in?
I know I'm going to hit the tip of northern tip of North Carolina, but I'll be up with Atlantic Dominion around the 15th of February. We're going to start event season again. Take me up into West Virginia. And if you've seen the West Virginia shops where there's a Square or Tobacco Town, almost how they support Southern Draw very well. I get a lot of rest when I'm there, but I look forward. We're going to jump into the Kentucky corner of Indiana and Tennessee. I hear we might be having an event in Clarksville, Tennessee, which is right outside the gates of 101st Airborne, Fort Campbell, Kentucky, which is so I'm excited about Lynn Cigars and Big Country, his brokerage, putting that together. And then we've got some exciting times, Will, that you don't know about. And I'll just announce it here. How about that?
Okay.
We are planning launch events. We'll starting in Dallas on March 4th, we're going to do Casa de Monte Cristo with the new launch there. And then toward the end of March, we're going to spend time. We're going to do a launch event there at JR in Mooresville.
Oh, wow.
And then we'll hit Selma and Burlington as well. Work out a relationship where we're going to be putting a Southern Draw into the retail side of JR and Casa de Monte Cristo. So we're going to spend time with the staff, and we're going to spend time with customers every one of those locations between now and the show.
They're great. You know, I haven't been to the Dallas one. I've obviously been to the JNR in Mooresville. Paul and I have both been there. And they're great shops. They're great people and a great atmosphere. So definitely, folks who are in those areas, I'd encourage them to check it out.
And those events are on the company Facebook page under the events. And I'm going to get better this year about every time I have a event that I'm going to attend, we'll make sure we document that well and try to promote it. So there'll be a new event schedule coming out here in the next couple of weeks. And, you know, February, March, and April, May are going to be very busy event schedule. We're going to spend quite a bit of time this year in Ohio, Pennsylvania, New York, New Jersey as well. So the East Coast, Mid-Atlantic, and the Northeast is going to see a lot of Southern Draw this first half of the year.
A lot to look forward to, and I encourage folks to check out Robert at an event. He's awesome there. So, Robert, thank you very much for appearing back on the Stogie Geek Show, and best of luck to you. I'm sure we'll be talking and seeing each other soon.
Yes, best of luck to you, sir.
Joe. I appreciate you. Great stand. You might just have to pull another chair up there for Brother Paul when he gets back. So I look forward to our next visit. I appreciate everything you guys have done and continue to do, not only for Southern Draw, but the industry as a whole. I'll commend you on being very prudent in reporting the news, because this news right now is vital. Education and being informed from the retailer, consumer, manufacturer side is more important than ever. So continue to do that. We appreciate it. I look forward to seeing you guys again, and we'll catch you on our trip out east as we work from south to north, and maybe we'll get a time to have a couple of the new blends when we get out there.
That'd be great.
Awesome. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate you.
Yep.
Appreciate it, Robert.